It's good to see everyone here, young, old, here in the house of the Lord in this evening. I see some youth up there in the balconies. If you guys want to come down here, there's plenty of room down here. And yes, I'm talking to you guys. You're acting like I don't see you. Just come on down here. We all want to worship together a little closer. So as we're singing, as we're getting started, go ahead and come down. As a matter of fact, let's all stand up. You guys from out there, just come down here, find a seat. And tonight we're going to talk about probably the most well-known verse in Scripture. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. Holy Father, in this evening, we pray that we take this message, O Lord God. Look at ourselves, Lord, and see that You have loved everyone, Lord. Help us to think of those around us because everyone matters, Lord. Everyone matters to You, therefore everyone should matter to us, Lord. Help us in this evening, God, to lay down our prejudices, our preconceptions, Lord God. And if need be, Lord God, even our programs, God, and let Your Spirit, God, work on our hearts, work on our minds. For in this evening, Lord, we come to serve You. We come to give You glory. Amen. Amen and amen.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord Almighty. Praise God. Amen. Before we go to the next song, I want to share just a passage of scripture with you. And you don't have to open up your Bibles. I'll just read it very quickly. This is from Exodus chapter 3, verse 13. Exodus chapter 3, verse 13. Then God, then Moses said to God, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. This is the God that we serve. This is the Lord our God that doesn't have a name like other so-called gods. He just is. He is the only true God. This evening, I believe with my heart that God has called us to be here in this evening to praise no other name than the great I am, to praise no other name than his holy name. If you believe that this evening, that we're serving a mighty God, a true God, who is the great I am, sing with us this next song.
Great I am.
This evening, Lord, that your spirit is beckoning us and is calling us, Lord, to worship, Lord. And I would like with everyone together to go into a moment of prayer. Cu toți împreună să ne rugăm împreună către Dumnezeul nostru. Eu sunt cel ce sunt. Haideți cu toți împreună to worship and pray to the great I am. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you. Meditations on our hearts, Lord God, be acceptable in your sight. My rock and my redeemer. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. And you may be seated, church. Turn to your neighbor, the left or right. Welcome them to the house of worship. Pacea Domnului. Hi, how are you?
Pace vouă. În acest moment ne vom îndrepta privirile spre anunțurile care le va face fratele Purcar. Poți te rog să scoți efectul de pe microfon. Mulțumesc. Îl rog pe fratele Purcar să vină, pe fratele Iosif să vină aici în față și el va face și colectă în această seară și ne va conduce mai departe în program.
Eu am să fac doar anunțurile și atât. Tinerii au programul lor în care nu vrem să ne amestecăm sau să îi deranjăm. Anunțurile care privesc biserica noastră, bineînțeles cei care au luat această hârtiuță, acest buletin duminical, e vorba de primul anunț și foarte important care e pentru sâmbăta următoare. Nu știu, merge microfonul bine sau îl aud eu rău. Duminica următoare, la 10 dimineața, 10 AM, ne vom întâlni aici împreună cu fratele Leonard Semeni, care va ține câteva seminarii de familii sau pentru familii. Bineînțeles, suntem invitați să venim aici. Eu zic să ne străduim să venim. Îl cunoaștem pe fratele Leonard, un om al lui Dumnezeu pe care Domnul folosește. Dumnealui va prezenta aceste seminarii sâmbăta viitoare, începând cu ora 10 dimineața, și va fi și o pauză și după aia va continua, după o pauză probabil ceva mâncare sau ce se va hotărâ în direcția aceasta. Și apoi duminică dimineața, din câte știu eu, fratele Semene va rămâne cu noi, iar seara, la slujba de seară, va fi fratele Sergiu Nichescu din Timișoara, România, acel om, acel bărbat care nu are mâini. Probabil că l-a mai văzut, a mai fost la noi la biserică, nu știu dacă a nimerit să fie duminica la biserică, dar este un bărbat fără mâini, care predică cuvântul lui Dumnezeu, care are o mărturisire extraordinară, felul cum s-a căsătorit, e ceva de necrezut pentru o minte omenească, ceea ce numai Duhul lui Dumnezeu poate să facă. Și cred că duminica următoare, la slujba de seară, o să auzim mărturia probabil și a surorii și a fratelui Nichescu. Domnul să-i binecuvinteze și pe fratele Leonard și pe această familie Nichescu. Amin. Apoi, în seara de 21 iunie, tot luna aceasta, o să fie primirea de noi membri și totodată o să sărbătorim pe cei care au terminat o școală, care au absolvit o școală, fie liceu sau alte facultăți. Domnul să ne binecuvinteze în acest sens. Luați acest buletin duminical, găsiți informațiile și numărul fratelui Alex Iriteu pe care trebuie să-l contactați pentru această lucrare. Apoi, cei care vreți să vă înscrieți pentru camp, de asemenea sunt informațiile pe acest bilețel. Și cei care vreți să vă înscrieți copiii la Bible School, a fost puse câteva anunțuri mai înainte de a începe slujba. Cei care ați fost aici ați putut să le vedeți. De asemenea, repet, este aici pe acest buletin și această informație. Dorim ca Domnul să binecuvinteze tinerii noștri și să pună mâna Lui peste ei. Nu vreau să vă mustru sau să vă cert, dar nu știu dacă este seara voastră, de ce vă puneți la balcon. A fost fratele Vasile Strâmbu și probabil că nu l-ați ascultat să coborâți jos. Eu vă mai invit odată, e seara voastră, coborâți jos, aici să stați, sunt bănci pe care voi, dacă coborâți de acolo, nu știu dacă umpleți două bănci, așa că e bine să coborâți aici în seară, în sală, e seara voastră, să cântați cu tinerii care cântă, să vă rugați împreună cu noi și probabil să nu faceți alte lucruri la balcon. Indiferent cine sunteți, vă rog să coborâți jos, aici este sala unde aveți locul, mai ales cei tineri. Domnul să vă binecuvinteze în sensul acesta. Noi nu vrem, și eu personal nu-mi doresc să fie o despărțitură, o rupere între noi, cei mai în vârstă, și voi tinerii. De aceea trebuie și voi să lucrați la lucrul acesta și noi cei în vârstă să lucrăm la lucrul acesta. Nu putem face numai ce vrem noi și ce ne vine nouă prin cap. Biserica Domnului trebuie să aibă reguli, rânduieli, pe care trebuie să le respectăm cu toții. Și în primul rând, în casa Domnului, trebuie să respectăm pe Domnul. Și Domnul să ne binecuvinteze la lucrul acesta. Am spus-o și în alte rânduri, eu n-am citit în Biblie niciodată că cei bătrâni trebuie să umble, să le facă mofturile celor tineri, ci invers, cere cuvântul ca cei tineri să fie supuși celor bătrâni, adică părinților voștri, și toți în legăturile voastre să fiți împodobiți cu smerenie, căci Dumnezeu stă împotriva celor mândri, dar celor smeriți le dă har. Domnul să vă binecuvinteze, dragi tineri și dragi părinți care suntem în această seară, să ne rugăm Domnului ca Domnul să lucreze în continuare. Eu vreau să vă spun, și eu am fost tânăr, dar fiind tânăr, eu am crescut pe lângă cei care conduceau adunarea. Eu n-am crescut pe lângă unul care avea aceeași minte ca mine și care, dacă am mințit, nu mi-a spus că am mințit, și dacă am făcut un lucru, nu mi-a spus că l-am făcut rău. Am crescut pe lângă frați în vârstă, păstori sănătoși în credință, și vreau să spun că mai târziu, peste ani, se va vedea bine pe lângă cine ai crescut. Se va vedea bine pe lângă cine ai crescut și vreau să vă spun că cine ascultă de părinții acasă, ascultă și de frați în biserică. Dacă n-asculți de părinții acasă, aceeași atitudine rușinoasă o ai și în biserică. N-asculți de păstori, tu ești cineva, tu te crezi cineva și în fond se va dovedi în timp, în luni și în ani, că de fapt n-ai fost nimic. Pentru că Dumnezeul nostru stă împotriva celor mândri. Și dacă Domnul stă împotriva mea, că sunt mândru și încrezut, vreau să te asigur că nu faci niciun pas și nu fac niciun pas. N-am nicio propășire. Așa că uită-te la lucrarea care o faci, dacă are propășire, dacă nu, zi pacea Domnului și ia o pauză. Ia o pauză. O lucrare care vine de la Domnul crește, propășește și are evoluție. Dacă nu are evoluție, înseamnă că e something wrong acolo. Așa că noi trebuie să... Vreau să vă spun, fraților, eu sunt felul de om, o spun și acasă, m-am repetat-o de multe ori și o spun și în biserică. Ce pentru mine scrie în cuvânt să vină un înger să-mi spună că e ok să trec pe acolo, eu nu trec. Eu nu trec. Asta știu copiii mei, puteți să-i întrebați. Dacă știu că lucrul ăla eu nu îl admit la mine în casă, el n-are voie să fie. O spun de câte ori trebuie și înainte să vin la biserică și după ce mă duc la biserică și dacă le întâlnesc în bucătărie și când mă duc să mă culc, oriunde, când le întâlnesc, dacă e de spus ceva, le spun. Pentru că vreau atunci când am să pun capul pe pernă și mai ales când am să mă întâlnesc cu Dumnezeul meu, să pot să stau cu capul sus. Dacă am face toți la fel și ne-am luptat toți în felul acesta, chiar dacă nu te ascultă copiii, tu rămâi înaintea Domnului un om integru. Dar dacă ne jucăm așa cu una și cu alta, nu merge. De aceea eu doresc ca Domnul să binecuvinteze lucrarea tinerilor de la noi din biserică. În primul rând, un om care umblă cu Dumnezeu, un tânăr care îl slujește pe Domnul, ăla în primul rând caută rugăciunea, caută postul, caută apropiarea de Domnul și asta se vede. Timotei n-a fost un om care a luat-o de capul lui, la care Pavel a tras atenția și a spus: Timotei, fii atent, înaintarea ta trebuie să fie văzută de toți. Nu trebuie să ai tu așa o viteză încât să fii singur pe freeway, să nu te mai vadă nimeni. Ori te duci prea în față, ori rămâi prea în urmă. Tu trebuie să mergi în pas cu biserica și cu lucrarea lui Dumnezeu. Și niciodată nu am citit în Biblie că Timotei s-a apucat să-i scrie o epistolă lui Pavel, ci invers. Pavel a scris lui Timotei. Deci trebuie. Vreau să vă spun cu durere în suflet. Sunt unele lucruri care, pe oricare dintre părinți, dacă l-ai întrebat, poate că nu le place. Pentru că nu le place. Pentru că, cum am spus, eu sunt un om deja trecut, un pic, mai mult, poate, la jumătate. Dar vreau să vă spun că am crescut pe lângă oameni. Niciodată n-am crescut de unul singur. Asta trebuie să fie și în biserică la noi. Trebuie să fie, pentru că o turmă care a încredințat-o Domnul apostolilor, turma a fost întreagă. A fost oițe, nu? Oi, oițe și miei. Dar trebuie să fie întreagă. Și la seara tinerilor trebuie să fie întreagă. Și duminică dimineața trebuie să fie întreagă. Și marți trebuie să fie întreagă tot timpul. Asta este turma Domnului. Nu ne-am împărțit pe turme. Ăia vin acolo, ăia merg dincolo, ăia se duc dincolo. Și ne întâlnim odată când și când la cina Domnului. Vreau să vă spun că la unii dintre voi, tineri fiind, nu-i numai odată pe lună adunare. Este adunare în fiecare duminică, este adunare în fiecare marți, este adunare în fiecare joi, este adunare în fiecare... Când am programat noi să fie adunare. Nu-i numai când vreți voi sau când vreau eu. Așa că Domnul să ne binecuvânteze. Am vrut să mă opresc, dar vă spun înaintea Domnului, cu frică și cu teamă, nu am putut să nu spun aceste lucruri. Indiferent dacă la cine v-a plăcut sau nu, mi-am făcut datoria și la noapte am să dorm foarte liniștit. Domnul să vă binecuvinteze. Și un mare semn de întrebare. Lucrarea care o faci, merge înainte, propășește. Dacă nu, ia o pauză și pocăiește-te. Și să mă pocăiesc și ceva trebuie schimbat. Domnul să ne binecuvinteze. Haideți să ne ridicăm în picioare. Cântăm împreună cu tinerii care vor cânta și apoi în timpul acestei cântări ne încânăm Domnului cu darurile noastre de bunăvoie. Domnul să ne binecuvinteze. Nu uitați, prima duminică din lună, cei care n-am făcut lucrul acesta dimineață, putem face acum. E duminica întâia din lună când ne închinăm Domnului cu darurile noastre de bunăvoie într-un mod aparte, susținând lucrarea Domnului și biserica și tot ce trebuie făcut cu acești bani. Amin. Cântă tinerii și ne închinăm Domnului.
stand accused. There's a list a mile long of all my sins, of everything that I've done wrong. I'm so ashamed. There's nowhere left for me to hide. This is the day I must answer for my life. My fate is in the judge's hands. But then he turns to me and says,
again, welcome to our youth night, as we call it. But as was said earlier, it's not our night. This is God's night. Not to the old, not to the young. This is God's night. Amen. I want to read very quickly from 1 Peter chapter 5. If we could put that verse up in Romanian as well. 1 Peter chapter 5, beginning with verse 1. 1 Peter chapter 5. And this goes hand in hand with what we're doing here. Working together and the church as a whole. So I exhort the elders among you, as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed, shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to your flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Likewise, you who are younger, and this is important, young people, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourself, all of you, with humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Amen. This is God's word for every single person here, for old, for young. We are here to celebrate God, to give glory to God in this evening. Amen, amen, and amen. And again, welcome. We are PRC Youth, as we have so named ourselves, Philadelphia Romanian Church Youth. We want to connect, we want to grow, we want to influence. One of these ways you could do that, we have some t-shirts out for sale. You could buy them after church. I don't want to advertise too much about that. We already talk about that enough during youth nights. But if you want it, just go ahead and purchase some after youth night tonight. Just a way to show that we're all in this together. And speaking of youth nights, we have started a new series on Friday nights that is about one of the most, if not the most, I would say the most important thing in our lives as Christians, and that's faith. That's faith. And the series is entitled Finding Faith Beyond. Finding Faith Beyond. And in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it says this: Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. And before I go any further, I do want to mention, if you want a translating device from English to Romanian, dacă doriți un aparat de traducere din engleză în românește pentru predica, nu o să predic eu acum, dar mai târziu un program, puteți să contactați un ușier. They can help you out. So if you know someone that would need a translation device from English to Romanian, please see the usher. Thank you. So faith. I want to spend a few minutes. After that, we're going to go into prayer together as a church. This chapter talks about many, many people that were heroes of faith. You could say the hall of faith. There's halls of fame for music, for rock and roll, for sports, for games, for everything you can imagine. This is almost like the hall of fame for faith. And the Word of God describes them to us. Some of them we would think are obvious. Some of them, surprising. Tonight I want to talk about a person that's mentioned the most in here. He's mentioned three times by name, and his wife once. This is Abraham and his wife Sarah. Abraham was commended as a man of faith, who was called out to go from city to city until finally he reached the land of Canaan. He was a wanderer, putting up tents wherever he went, and a worshiper, putting up altars wherever he came to. And God asked him to do things that are seemingly impossible. For example, God promised them an impossible child. In Genesis 12, God first promises Abraham and says, "From you, I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the heaven and the grains of sand on the sea." Now, Abraham was already very, very old at this point. He was, if I'm not mistaken, about 75 years old at this point. His wife was 65 years old. They didn't have a child that year. They didn't have a child the next year. In fact, only when Abraham was 100 years old and Sarah 90 did she conceive a child. In seemingly impossible circumstances, they had a child. And they named him, what's his name? Isaac. They named him Isaac. So the child grew, and the Bible says that he grew up to be a strong young lad. And then God called Abraham to an impossible sacrifice. More importantly, in Genesis 22, he called Abraham. He said, "Take your son Isaac, whom I have given you, go to Mount Moriah, and present to him as a sacrifice to me." Moses, or rather Abraham, did as he was told. Notice he didn't put up a fight with God. He didn't try to negotiate with God. A few chapters earlier, when God appeared to Abraham and said, "I am going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah," Abraham seemed to put up a fight almost. Am I right? He said, "Lord, if you find 100 righteous people, please save the city." God said, okay, if I find 100 righteous people, I'll save the city. He didn't find 100 righteous people. And then Abraham gets saying, if you find 50, 40, if you find 10 righteous people, please do not destroy the city. God couldn't find 10 righteous people, but he saved Lot and his family. For people he didn't even know, Abraham pleaded for God not to destroy the city. Yet for his own son, he didn't put up a fight. Why? Why did he not say, God, you've promised that you would give me a son, this son. God, are you a just God? Why are you taking his life? Remember that God is sovereign over life. He gives and he takes away. God, what will others say about you? He is a sovereign king. Abraham did as he was told. He went to the mountain. And we all know the story. As he was raising up the knife, the dagger, he heard a voice, Abraham, do not lay a hand on that child. Abraham, it says in Hebrews 11, chapter 12, for Abraham saw fit that even God could raise him from the dead. This is very important for us. Abraham's faith had grown so much that by the time he was with his son Isaac, he believed that God could even raise his son from the dead. Now, for us in our Western minds, in our Christian minds, that we're, you know, we were raised in the church, we read about the resurrection, we say, oh yeah, of course, God can raise from the dead. But this was a big deal thousands of years ago to think like this. Faith so strong that God could raise him to life. I'd like for us to stand, and we're going to pray in this evening. And I want to point out, as it says in Matthew, Jesus came and told his disciples, with men, all these things are impossible. An impossible child at 100 years old. An impossible sacrifice. Or in your case, whatever is impossible in your life. Whatever's going on in your life that you see no means of escape. And you look to people. And you look to friends. Maybe even parents. And they just can't help. It's impossible. I want to challenge you, just as Abraham found faith beyond the impossible, to remember that as Jesus said, going back to Matthew, with men all these things are impossible, but with God all things are possible. With God all things are possible. So, in this prayer, come before the Lord and say, Lord, I know that this is impossible in my life. This is impossible. This is impossible. But God, I trust you. I trust that with you all things are possible, Lord. I lay down, oh Father God, my worries, my fears at your feet, God, and I humble myself, Lord God, before others and before you especially. And I'd like for us to go with that attitude, with that humbleness into prayer, asking God to complete the impossible in our lives because he makes all things possible. Amen? Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that in this evening, Lord, you have made, oh Father God, the impossible possible. You have made, oh Heavenly Father, the things that we see, oh Father God, as not being able to be fulfilled by our own powers, oh God, or by the people of this earth, oh Lord Jesus. I pray, oh God, for you to work, God, in my life. For all the things, God, that seem impossible, Lord God, I know, God, that you make this possible, Lord God. Oh, Father, I pray for anyone, God, who's praying, Lord, that you have a strong will, God, that you have a place in your life, God, that you need Jesus, that we can't find those things. I pray, oh Heavenly Father, for you to make it possible, Lord. One, the only, oh Father God, that can bring forth God possibilities in our lives, Lord Jesus. May you bless, oh Father God, those who are seeking your name, who are seeking your power, oh Lord Jesus, who want, oh Father God, to worship, who are lifting up your name in their lives, oh God. Lord, may you show yourself, oh Father God, in their lives, oh God. May you show yourself, oh God, in their lives, oh Father, and present yourself, God, in the things that are impossible for us, to make the things possible for you, Lord Jesus. Oh, Father, we bring before you, Father God, my problem, God, my addiction, my things, God. They're keeping me, God, from a better relationship with you, from a more personal relationship with you, Father God. Oh, Father, you are the one, oh, Lord God, who can move mountains, oh, God, before us. You are the one who can move the things before us, oh, Father God, that we see as impossible, Lord God. And we thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And you may be seated, church. Thank you.
Vacation Bible School, and I want to give you guys a little information, more detailed information about that. It's going to be on July 6th through the 10th, and starts at 9 in the morning, goes all the way to about 12:30. The ages for the children that will be involved will range from ages 4 to about 12 or 13. The cost per child is $20 per child, and that covers all their activities, their t-shirts, their crafts, their games, and a snack time. Really briefly, I want to mention how the days will be progressed. Each day will flow just about the same. It'll be broken down in about 5 segments. The kids will have a time of worship. They're going to have a time of Bible and teaching. They're going to have a time for arts and crafts. They're going to have a time for recreation, and they're going to have a small amount of time for snacks. We encourage you, each one of you, to sign up your kids. If you have kids in this age range, to sign up your kids. But more than signing up your kids, we are in desperate need of volunteers. And to give you a number of how many volunteers we need roughly 300 volunteers for this to work. I say 300, and that's because maybe that's the rough number that I see here tonight. And I'm asking each and every one of you to help us out in prayer and fasting during the next couple weeks. We have about a month ahead of us. And more than money, more than actual physical labor, we need for you guys to pray for these kids. The theme for this VBS comes out of Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21, and it says, "And whenever you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear this command behind you. This is the way. Walk in it." The overall theme revolves around Daniel and his time with his three friends. And the topic says journey off the map. Talks about Daniel's journey through that land, and when the king over and over and over had specific commands on what he could do and what he couldn't do, and Daniel still figured out solutions with God's help on how to journey through that. So I want to encourage you guys to pray for these kids as you guys sign them up. There are volunteers in the hallway right now. They will be there through the end of service and after service when you get a chance, preferably after service. Please sign up your kids, and the deadline to sign up your child is July 1st. I want to stress over and over, there's a desperate need for this generation, for this young generation, to develop a mentality that is focused on having God direct their lives, having God showing them every step of their journey. And as we see in today's society, as we journey through life, we see that society attempts to change the way we think about marriage, attempts to change the way we define marriage, and numerous other topics that, coming from a youth convention, we had a sermon that was preached on homosexuality. And there was actually a young brother that one of us grew up with, that he got up and he was very disturbed by this message, by the message that is in the Bible, by the message that we have grown up with as kids. So I want to encourage you guys, pray and fast for this VBS, pray and fast for your kids and all the volunteers needed. If you guys have any extra time on your hands as parents, as older brothers and sisters, and you want to get involved as well, please contact me or any one of the volunteers in the hallway and sign up to help as a volunteer basis as well. Thank you so much. I would like to call up, invite Manu and Juana to lead us into a few songs. Thank you.
Oh, Check one, two, check, we're on. All right, cool. Before we sing these songs, I just have a quick thought just to share with you guys something that really, really encouraged my heart. I heard this not too long ago. It's about a testimony of a preacher. He was invited to speak at a political conference. He was invited to actually not speak, but pray at a political conference. What that meant that he was invited together with other religious speakers to come in front of thousands and thousands of people and just pray the way they pray. So he was invited together with a Muslim speaker, an Islam speaker, and he was invited to pray as a Christian minister. So he got there, and in the backstage, the organizer kind of told him, hey, make sure you pray politically correct. You know, we are in a political gathering. We just don't want to make people feel uncomfortable. So at that point, he was in a dilemma. He didn't know, what should I do? Should I just do exactly what they say? My spirit says something else. And the Muslim got up and prayed, and he prayed in the name of his gods, and it was okay. And then the Islam got up there and prayed, and everything was fine. And then he got up and he wanted to pray. So he was dealing with so much fear and so much attacks from the devil. And, you know, he got up there and the audience was in front of him, and he simply just sat there for a few seconds and let the spirit just come into the room. And he said, in the name that is above all the other names, in the name of the who was, he who is, and yet to come, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, that is above all the other names, we pray. And in that moment, the room erupted with praise and clap in a political gathering. Again, not a church, political gathering. So he just didn't know what to do. He just went backstage. The organizers came out to him, and they were like, what in the world is going on? What's happening? He was like, our preacher goes, man, I have no idea. The only thing that I do know is that there is still power in the name of Jesus Christ. And tonight, I just wanted to proclaim that over this church, over this youth, over every individual in this room. You are not here by a mistake. You are not here just because it's a church service. You are here because I believe you are in need of the power of Jesus Christ tonight. And I pray that God will bless you and honor you tonight in Jesus' name. So we're going to sing a couple of songs în românește. Și avem și cuvintele pregătite. Dacă vreți, chiar vă invităm să cântați împreună cu noi.
Te văzuse înconjurat de o mulțime cerând mila ta, speranțele ascunse de o boală prea grea ce nimeni n-o putea alina. Dar în sufletul ei își spunea, doar să mă ating de haina sa și voi fi vindecată acum.
În cetate pe când intrai, cu credință un om a venit. Nu sunt vrednic să intri în casa mea, dar pentru al meu rob milă-ți cer. Zdrobit, chinuit de dure, doar un cuvânt să rostești, Doamne, și va fi eliberat. Azi vin și eu, mă-nchin înaintea tronului, de mielul preasfânt mă apropii, căci nu s-a sfârșit îndurările tale. Ieri, azi și-n veci, Tu ești același Dumnezeu. Tu ești același Dumnezeu.
Că s-a sfârșit îndurările tale. Ieri, azi și în veci, Tu ești același Dumnezeu. Tu ești același Dumnezeu.
Trece Iisus,
trece Iisus pe aici, trece Iisus pe aici, cheamă-L și cere îndurare, trece Iisus pe aici, de ești trudit și ți-e grea povara, nu vrei chiar astăzi să te ridici. Iată e clipa hotărâtoare, trece Iisus pe aici,
trece Iisus pe aici. Care nu s-a schimbat și nu se schimbă și nu se va schimba niciodată, este Cel care va veni, Domnul nostru Iisus. Chiar vă rugăm să vă ridicați în picioare la cântarea asta și să cântăm Celui care este vrednic de toată slava și închinarea, Celui care a venit și a murit pentru noi și care va veni și ne va răpi la cer.
Multă pace am găsit când eram chiar doborât. Eu chiar dacă aș fi lovit, pot să spun
love.
aproape aceea zi, când cei vechi va fi iar nou, tot ce-i umbră va pieri. Prin Iisus vom trăi, prin Iisus toți vom trăi.
Iisus a biruit și mormântul a părăsit. Victoria ia lui, înviat e dintre morți și din mormânt. Când mă va chema
me to set the context to Romanian before I continue. Cât știu că Dumnezeu este prezent aici. Pentru cei care nu știu și ați auzit pe cineva vorbind, întoarceți-vă la cineva și spuneți-i: Dumnezeu, Iisus Hristos, cel răstignit și acum viu, este printre noi seara aceasta. Cât a zis aia cu gura lor?
E greu să știi că cineva poate trăi pentru Dumnezeu, să aibă o pasiune care chiar mută munții și noi ne chinuim cu lucruri de nimic. Poți și eu să fiu open? Aș vrea să vă întreb, dacă știe cineva limba română, să mă iertați dacă greșesc, eu sunt născut aici în America. Pentru cei care nu mă știu, numele meu nu e important. Am fost aici printre voi acum 4 ani în urmă. Am un băiat atât de frumos. 2 ani jumătate cu soția mea, sub harul lui Dumnezeu și binecuvântarea fratelui păstor, am avut noi ocazia să venim în vizită. Mesajul de pe seara aceasta înseamnă ceva pe care e greu de conceput. Că toți, fiecare persoană este importantă. Contextul o spun în limba română și după aia o să vorbesc în limba română, în limba engleză cursiv. Dacă în caz că nu înțelegeți limba engleză, avem un traducător profesional. Dacă Dumnezeu este un râu de viață, apa curgătoare, fiecare om pe pământ are o parte de acel râu, că e făcut din Dumnezeu. Amin? Când Dumnezeu ne cheamă să trăim pentru El, ne cheamă să facem parte de un râu care aduce viață. Problema e, de multe ori noi, cu găleata noastră, luăm o bucată de apă, ne retragem la umbră și privim râul. Și credem că l-avem pe Dumnezeu pentru că am prins și noi o apă care acum a ajuns să fie static în găleata noastră. Și după multă vreme de pauză, stai și te privești în stânga, în dreapta, cine are găleata mai puternică, mai mare, că acolo este Dumnezeu. Și vreau să vă readuc aminte, venind din Dallas, să vă spun că Dumnezeu nu locuiește în găleți. Amin? Haideți să ne rugăm Domnului împreună în timp ce eu cer binecuvântarea Domnului peste acest mesaj. God, I come before you and I pray that you may work miracles tonight. I pray because it broke my heart as well when I found out yesterday that my wife's grandfather, fratele Bodia, passed away. I say that not because he was necessarily important. I say that because life is fragile. And today we worship your name with people that we call friends, that people we call family. God, open our eyes to see that people matter. Open our hearts that we may live as you live, not judgmental creatures, measuring buckets, thinking that the things we offer you are important. Teach us what it means, Lord Jesus, to make a difference on this earth. And I pray that you speak at our level, at our way of understanding. In your name we pray. Amen. Haideți să reocupăm locurile. God is, according to Scripture, a river. This river moves in ways that I seen just a little bit with floods and rivers throughout my growing up, if I could even say that. If God were to be a river, that means humanity makes part of what God is in. Many times we're quick to say God is not in that. God is not in this. And the Bible that I've read in a presentation of God's persona, his Trinitarian presence, differs with sometimes my own belief. In our own life, we may realize it or not, but sometimes you influence people. The way you think you look, the insecurity you may feel at night, the challenges you have that are all at the level of the mind, shadow in comparison to what God has invested in you. I don't know if you know how valuable you are. And I'm challenging your thought process tonight. It has nothing to do with me, and it surely has nothing to do with you. We are just wind. That when God pushes us in a direction, a sailboat would go forward. We're just partners in this river that when it crevices the ground, life happens. Trees blossom. Flowers explode with perfume and joy. Animals come and are nurtured. Families are birthed. Why? Because I did something. Because I was created by someone who invested in me what he is. Is God the river of life? Is he the water that when you drink, you'll never go thirsty again? Are you on the sideline or are you in that river? That at one time you did taste and it took over so much that you jumped in the river, never thirsty again. Four years I haven't been here and I see new faces. And I see things that have happened periodically, and I've been watching you guys on social media. And let me tell you, don't ever let someone despise your youth. Satan will always come with some truth to corrupt you. Satan will always speak with conviction and then add a verse at the end to make it look like what he's saying is authentic. The only thing that is authentic that you could always take to the Bible is love, not words. Love. When you look at Everybody Matters, do you think of you, your children, your wife, your husband? Or do you think of your neighbors that are Romanian, that are American, that are from Europe? How broad do you think? Does your everyone include people beyond what is comfortable to you? If so, the Bible says you're progressively becoming sanctified. If not, you're chilling with a bucket of stale water, claiming you have the power of God, but lacking the power thereof. I sit and I think in my own life, what makes people passionate? For those that know me and for the conversations I've had, even before I got here, I always am a hunter of passion. What makes you passionate? What makes you fall in love with something? It's not who you are. And many times that's the way we categorize life. Who are you? It's not who you are. The Bible's only question is, who are you becoming? There can be a challenge in our communities where we stop asking the right questions because we think we have some type of understanding. The wisest people I have ever met, and I've met some people that have written, that have been prize winners, that have had multiple people listen to their words. The wisest I've ever met are the people that the first words they said is, I know nothing. I know nothing. And everything I am is because God is creating me to be something. The more you live, the more life will surprise you. Isn't that true? When you think you understand how someone will react, God has a way of a child breaking all your preconceived notions. I love to interact with people. I think it's something that may irritate my beloved wife, and it's the curse she has to bear. That every time we go somewhere and we try to have a romantic dinner, every time we're walking from a car that we've parked to a building to have dinner, if there's someone there and they somehow give me eye contact, I stop and I ask, who are you becoming? And sometimes it's a homeless person, And sometimes as someone, I am shocked what they say. How much do you really love people? Do you see people as co-partners in a river? Or do you see people as a bunch of people outside of your existence and your job is to bring them in the river? I repeat, if God is the river of life, and all humanity has what God invested, you're in the river with me, even if I can't stand you, and even if I love you. The question is not who you are, but what is God doing amongst us? Who are we becoming? In preparation to this night, a word in Romans 8:38 says, nothing will separate you from the love of God. Nothing. And I sat and I thought, Lord, if I'm part of your river, in a crevice of this land, designing whatever portrait you do, when I hit a rock, how will I react? When something comes my way, how will I tremble? Am I of water? Am I of you, Lord? Or am I my own creation? Because if you are your own creation, your foot will hurt. Your back will hurt from the load you carry. Because every person is trying to get a bigger bucket. Every person has a list of things they want to accomplish. Every person. I've never met someone who wakes up in the morning and says, I woke up this morning because I am bored with life. They always woke up to either go to the bathroom, go to a career, change this world. Something, they had a purpose, regardless of how minute it may be. If you are struggling, and I use a word that I don't even agree with, struggling, how can you be water, clash against a rock, and stop? Water's fluid. Water molds. Whatever falls in the river, the water will surround with its own entity. Amen? If God truly is that river, and we truly are that river, why do we categorize people if God sees everyone as himself? I'm just asking questions. Hosea married a woman that did not love him. And you know what the Bible says? That Hosea made a commitment before God that he will allure her back with kind words. For those that don't know, there was a man told, commanded by God to love a woman that has been loving multiple men. She's in the sex trafficking industry. And because that illustration God wanted for us to read of how we love him, he said, pursue her. Do you know his conclusion of how to love her? Was to control his words. Only an arrogant person can say you're stupid and then finish with I love you. Only a twisted, bipolar individual can use words, you're great, but let me kick you. Only people who are not of what God is of will use persona with some truth to manipulate, coerce, undermine your youth. I don't know about you, I feel young. I have a friend who's 67. I play golf with him almost every week. He doesn't feel old. His body's breaking down. But he doesn't feel old. New passions, new life. It's almost around him on some subjects, I get a glimpse of a running water that you just hear it and it's beautiful. The river has a potential to carry you in the current. Why so many people have ambition that resist the current? Has anyone ever gone in a flowing river and tried to stop it? What happens? Your body gets tired. You start seeing life in terms of what you can stop, not just going with the flow. There are some people that think they hear God similar to Saul, the way he had a passion, a zeal towards the things he thought were of God, and his whole mission was to kill people. If you don't know this story, it's in the Bible. It's kind of interesting. Where this simple man heard a voice of God and started murdering people that said they love each other. And somehow God does something miraculous, includes him in the river, gives him a taste that he's never thirsty again. And somehow his life changes. One of the biggest heartbreaks that I've ever had was after I understood this verse, John 4:14. It shattered my world. Whoever drinks of the water that I give them, says Jesus, will never go thirsty again. The water that I give him or her will become a spring of water welling up to eternal life. If you've ever floated in water, imagine floating in a river. That river will take you at whatever speed it's traveling. The end journey is Jesus, is eternity. Right now, enjoy the ride. How hard is that to think in your own life? Waking up tomorrow saying, God, everything I have is yours. I will enjoy the ride from today. You'll have skeptics looking at someone young. You're not doing anything with your life. You need to have a plan. You need to find a way to fit into my preconceived notion of what society is, of what culture is, of what our church represents. And if you don't, you're a heretic. You need my love, right? You need my involvement. We'll talk to the comité. We'll come up with a great strategy to change your mind because you're on the wrong path. Why invest time in stopping a river? Why? The next verse changes some things for me. John 7:38. Whoever believes in me, Jesus again, which always has great words. As the scriptures has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Did you know that when you know the words of Jesus well enough, your words become like Osea, capable of making even a woman that devoted everything to you, fall back in love with you every single day as if she has dementia and forgets how to love tomorrow. I pastor a church, twisted, weird, I've heard it all. The name is called Metanoia. It's a Greek word that means skimbaria minsi, translated in Cornilescu, pokainza, repentance, the changing of the mind. My whole life, I thought ministry is changing what you do, changing what you say, changing how I look. And from the very get-go of me praying an audacious prayer, saying, God, use me, he introduces people that include everyone to mold the way I thought. From a woman who was free in her Christianity with a man who grew up in America under a communistic style of ministry to be broken and challenged of why I hate certain things. There were even certain colors. I remember having the first argument with my wife. You know what it was about? The pointy shoes. I hated pointy shoes. At that time, pointy shoes were in being introduced in fashion. And I thought, that is not of God. And when you see a person's heart and love, you don't care about pointy shoes. The most beautiful thing to be around people of God is they give you the freedom to float in water and enjoy the current. What kind of person are you? Is it finished? Or are you becoming something new? I pray we are becoming something new. Amen? Something that inevitably is better because tomorrow is not yesterday. In the essence of God's control, how he created this earth to be governed by science and law, tomorrow will come and yesterday will never come again. I say the church that I pastor is really at my house in Dallas. I've had moments, senior pastor of a bigger church, a smaller, doesn't matter. It was irrelevant. When God changed my mind, I gathered with about 15 friends. They were friends because now I've been with them for 8 months. And there were people like me, and many times in my life, where I did not understand what it meant to be of God, in God. So we decided to open up a church. They were all there. And just to give you a preview of what happens in the people I consider my everyone, there was a woman, she stood up, interrupted my little sermon, as if someone were to stand up and start speaking now. And she goes, go fill up the bathtub, I want to get baptized. I didn't talk about baptism. I wasn't pushing an agenda. All I said was, we're not waiting for numbers to declare that this is an open place for everyone. We're opening the church today. And this was about a month ago. Guess what all the other people in the room said to her? Congratulations. Oh, let me. Nah, not one. They all said, are you sure? Think about it. There's no pressure. Are you sure? And so she repeated it her third time, and I kind of with an authoritative voice, because it was my house, I told my wife, Adela, how many times does this woman have to tell you she wants to get baptized only for you guys to try to talk her out of it? Go fill up the water and grab a towel and get ready because we're about to have a baptism. The woman that got baptized was the founder of the Orthodox Church in Dallas 28 years ago. When she got baptized, with 10,000 plus Romanians there, then all of them, I see all of them, but maybe not all, they're professional. Their mentality is beyond forcing themselves to fit in a box, and they gave up some, and others did not, but expanded their horizon. They called her and said, are you crazy? Why would you change after at 60-some years old that you are? Why would you change? And she said the words, and it's on video, I love Jesus. He has loved me, and he always will love me. Her husband was not her first choice. He's an American guy. He's my golf partner. He wouldn't miss that moment for the world, and it was in my little bathroom. How many experiences do you have? Has nothing to do with you. Has everything to do with him. Or are we trying to categorize people and who they are instead of giving them the freedom to become? See, when God speaks of knowledge, the scriptures said, and those who held the scripture have become the springs of water, he's talking about his word. The love, the idea of God that's been captured through hundreds and centuries and over 48 authors collectively trying to understand who God is in a book called the Bible. That when you understand that you are reading a story of life instead of an instruction manual how to live, the knowledge now becomes your words, your approach. You actually become missional for the first time in your life. The word that they use in psychology is self-mastery. A person who walks and speaks with such clarity that regardless of who he encounters, people leave his presence knowing who he is and what he stands for. That's called self-mastery. Who was the ultimate master? A name pops to your mind. Hope it's Jesus. The ultimate. People saw him as the master that could walk with such elegance like Osia, looking at people that were just misunderstood, miscategorized, forced to feel insecure, pushed to feel lesser so that somebody can feel stronger just because they have a bucket with some water in it that thinks is their anointing and permission to undermine you. And undermine you. Living for God should not be as hard as we're making it. And that sounds audacious to say. But when you love without seeing, just feeling, when you can look at a person and see their soul, see the essence of God, not the essence of what your eyes translate, God begins to do something great in your life, not just in theirs. How many think that your approach is important? Instead of just speaking and then throwing a stamp of approval at the end, saying, yes, I heard God, so I will speak. What if all the angels in scripture were ignored? What if the donkey that was used of God was ignored by people that said, I will ignore a donkey because a donkey cannot be used by God because a donkey at the end of the day is an ass. At the end of the day, it's something that is not me and I will never be ridden, abused, or manipulated. So that's not my role model. And let alone that them speaking or that donkey being used, I will not accept it as a move of God. I love speaking to people who grew up or at least heard scripture stories. I don't have to reference everything in the Bible. And we can just flow like a dialogue. I have obviously friends, older friends and newer friends from here in Atlanta. And they said, what's the future of the Romanian church? You know what I said? I don't know. All I know is I was born in America. Out of seven children, I was the first here. My parents were just ambitious people that wanted to come here to give us an opportunity. In time, I tried to understand the culture by going to Romania, even studying there, marrying a Romanian woman because she was free and I was never free. I was in love with something that I could not understand. Only to come to a nation that is trying to promote their agenda with the people who claim are God's citizens in this country, doing the same thing, categorizing people according to whoever has the bucket. The future is in need of people who know how to talk. Not that's it. That's not it. People who know how to talk in love. People who know how to express themselves because God is communicating with them. People who see other people as part of the same river they've always been in. The only person that can mess things up for you is you. It's not my fault that you leave out of here angry. And it's no one's fault that you're not happy. It's your fault. And I don't know if that strikes a chord. So let me say it differently. Find, and this is an assignment, in the next 6 months, choose six people. Six people. And make them your friend. How? By listening. But only choose the six that make you angry. Do not choose people you're comfortable with. Because comfortable people only will say what I want to hear, so I'm smiling. Find people you've struggled with, understanding or not. See them as God and stop judging them and listen to their heart. You'll discover people who have been raped from someone who said they love them. You'll discover people who are sourcing their heart to drugs, to alcohol, to a means of living, thinking that there is understanding when there is not understanding. What's the future of our church, of the Romanian people, or better said, Christianity? The future is a bunch of people who are becoming better communicators. We need to learn how to have dialogue. Because the moment you get mad and the moment you get antsy, what's the first thing you do? You retreat. You run away because you don't understand it. You categorize it as demonic because you don't want to deal with it. I haven't seen Jesus be scared. The only time I saw Jesus run was from praise. Was from people exalting him instead of what God was doing on this earth. I have a plane scheduled horribly, so I have to leave at around 8. I want to finish with these words. What cause are you representing? Do you love trees and you're a tree hugger? More power to you. Do you love cars and you dedicate your life to capturing the vehicle that in that picture a person can see the passion of beautiful engineering? More power to you. Are you an artist, a singer, a player? That no one will understand what it means to dedicate 80 hours in almost a week in a few days just until your fingers are numb so you can kind of feel and translate in that instrument what's going on in your soul. A person asked me, Aaron, where is your life? You've been all over. And I said, I've been searching God. I really have. Trying to understand what he wants from me. And every time I thought I had success, I automatically allowed God to make me disgusted, thinking that I influenced something good. Until I would say, this can't be it. There has to be more. I don't care how people see me. I really don't. I don't care if they think changing a bucket or doing this is what they categorize as stability. I don't ever want to be stable going to hell. I don't ever want to be stable not loving. I want to be schizo. Some days I want to love so well that I don't even know what anointing is over me. And some days I want to recognize when I've been coerced by the evil one. I want to be able to understand myself. I want to understand what it means to be a master of the self. I don't need another degree to claim that I know. I don't care what you have or what you don't have. If you don't see God when you see everyone, there's something missing. There's something missing. Ossia, married and loved. New Testament passage is John 3:16. He loved you so much that he gave it all for you. Knowing how you'll feel, your inconsistencies, what you value as important and what not. And he committed to be a river that eventually will contact your life, your surrounding, and what was at the beginning your everyone, that included your husband, your wife, and your children. His goal is not for you to limit yourself. His goal is for you to expand. Amen? In closing, I want to say this. The river Nile, the Nile River, over 4,000 years old in terms of record keeping. 4,000 miles long, I'm sorry. 4,000, like 48 something, miles long, going through Egypt, is known to be the largest and most influential river in history. It dates back to the first artist, to the first community, the first civilization. And I sat, and as this whole theme just began to, I want to say, explode in my heart, God guides me through a person that I would never have expected. I was just playing chess. And he begins to talk about the Nile River. And I confirm it according to scripture that there was something in a place that civilizations began to build houses. People began to have artistic inclinations. People began to produce. People began to think. People began to have art and understand what culture meant. And where was it? Far from the river or near the river? It was near the river. The things that God uses will always mold us. Let me say it a little differently. If we are part of the river of life, instead of running away with a little bit of water, thinking we now have God, let's collectively work together. Those in Dallas, those here, and other people with the big C in front of their name. They belong to the Christ Church. And let's guide the river in such a way where we go to new land, to new people, to new things. And let them experience for the first time what it means to be nurtured, to have the vitamins that only water can produce. That life may exist in areas of a person's life that has never existed before. But it's going to cause sacrifice. You know what? Sacrifice is not easy. Because after many years of me investing with a team, investing with a church, investing with somebody, when you do a change, those that have been eating or drinking from the river may not have a river anymore to drink from. And you know what's beautiful? Beautiful about God? He allowed humanity to have a soul and a free will. And Jesus does cry, or God may cry, when the bird may not have where to have a nest. He'll take care of them. The Bible teaches us he cares for all living things. But do you think God would want you to stay where you are so the animals and the flowers can have what to benefit from? Or were you put on this earth to influence humanity? Were you put on this earth to allow the river collectively to go in areas that have never been before, have never seen water, has never seen a flower blossom, where us humans are attracted to beauty? There cannot be beauty in a desert if a river did not show itself first. Because what once was a desert became a worship ground for the things and the people that yet have to experience the river of life. I don't need this to make sense. We live in a social media type of context where anything recorded can be replayed. Anything that can be replayed can, with some creativity, be attracted with some translation. We can have a dialogue. I'm sure many have brought the subject up before. This is just my contribution. What are we becoming? If we truly are investing hours, and I know you guys are, during the week to come together, not just to do what Nati says, but to capture what God has anointed the leaders to be, a representation of something fluid, not blocked because somebody thinks that they have God more than you because they have a bucket. Enjoy the river. Enjoy being free. Enjoy going in areas that no one has ever gone before. Because collectively, that's how you make a difference. Can we all stand? And I know they're going to sing something, and I want it to be with the spirit of prayer in your heart. So I'm going to ask every person here to close your eyes and bow your head. I don't know what you consider yourself. I don't know how you would answer the question of who you are. But even if you don't have a clear understanding, do me a favor, if you will, let's throw it out of our thinking box. Let's change our mentality. Who cares what we are? Who cares if people try to remind us who we are? That's irrelevant. From this night forward, I do not care. All I care is who I am becoming. Where is God leading us? Where is the river gonna touch and form new life that people may enjoy this world and the existence that God has graced them to experience love in its most beautiful form? Diversity is just a synonym of Jesus. So I ask you, if till this night, with every eye and every head bowed, if till this night you've been answering the wrong question, and you want to ask the right question with me, look at me right now. I see you. I see you. I see you. I'm still asking it the same. God, yeah, you are becoming great on this earth, and we're a part of it. So let's ask Him together in prayer. Teach us what it means to become more like you, Jesus. Teach us what it means to jump in head first and enjoy the ride of a most rushing, loud, exuberant, beautiful, exciting, and refreshing river that we've ever imagined. But I want to be a part of it. How about you? How about you? I don't need you to come forward, and I don't need you to do anything that's on the outside impressive. Speak to God in your heart. If till today you still saw people as categories, as names, and you don't see everybody as a part of God in His plan, maybe you think yourself too important. Maybe you do. And I'm going to do what every preacher does, say they're almost done and then keep talking. So let me finish with this illustration. They asked me, what do you feel like, Aaron? And I said, I felt like a man on a boat with all the seasons of life crashing all at once, creating the perfect storm. And I am kind of like Peter right now, walking on water, expecting to fall because I'm no greater than Peter. And then God humbled me one day. Yeah, life can feel like that storm. Yes, life collided can make you feel like you're about to drown. But Aaron, you're not like that. You know what you really are? You're like a kite in my world, of a strong and ever powerful hurricane. And you're going in every direction that you could possibly imagine with no sense. Organized chaos is what I somehow could think of. And the only thing that's keeping you from flying away is my two fingers that is holding the string. I chose to hold you. I chose to hold you. If not, I would have never given you life. Can you be a kite in the midst of so much chaos that it does not make sense, but the only thing you can say is, God, thank you for holding me in the difficult times of my life? Or are you going to be a person that blames someone else and something else? As we worship together, speak to God. Have dialogue with new people and see how your heart can be expanded once you go over your self-pious judgment heart. I love you. And I pray and I know God will continue to do great things in the midst of Atlanta. Amen. God bless you.
Oh,
mai important, cel mai principal a fost un mesaj al dragostei. Și dacă nu am învățat în această seară ce înseamnă dragostea, când o să învățăm? Mesajul din această seară și tema tradusă în românește înseamnă fiecare persoană este importantă. De multe ori credem că persoanele cele mai importante sunt persoanele care vorbesc cele mai frumos sau cei mai frumos. Sau vorbesc cu o pasiune, sau vorbesc cu o putere. Dar în această seară am învățat că viitorul bisericilor noastre sunt în persoanele care știu să vorbească cum? Cu dragoste. Toată lumea poate să vorbească dur. Dar câți dintre noi putem să iertăm? În momentul în care omenirea a întors spatele lui Dumnezeu, Dumnezeu putea să spună: am terminat cu voi cu toți și facem din nou ce am făcut în timpul lui Noe. Dumnezeu a promis că nu va mai trimite apă, dar putea să trimite altceva, putea să trimite foc. Cred că putea să descopere ceva. Și ce a făcut? Probabil a simțit să facă lucrul ăsta și a mers exact în partea cealaltă. A trimis ce a avut mai scump. În loc să ne pedepsească, și-a dat viața. Acesta este un mesaj al dragostei. Fiindcă atât de mult a iubit Dumnezeu lumea, de ce? Că lumea a făcut ceea ce a fost bine? Nu! Că a dat pe singurul lui Fiu. Pentru cine? Pentru mine. Eu sunt cel mai păcătos. Dacă am creșit noi cu ceva, îmi iau vina peste noi, peste mine, în această seară. Dumnezeu să mă ierte pe mine, să ne ierte pe noi, dar să învățăm mesajul dragostei lui Dumnezeu. Viitorul bisericilor noastre constă în oameni care știu să arate dragostea lui Dumnezeu. Vă rog să puneți pe ecran în această seară 1 Corinteni 13. Dumnezeu ne-a iubit atât de mult că ne-a lăsat aproape un capitol întreg care vorbește despre dragoste. 1 Corinteni, capitolul 13, dacă puteți să-l puneți pe ecran. Vedeți că și cu mine au probleme, nu numai cu dumneavoastră. Cei de la media vorbesc. Aș dori împreună, nu eu singur, cu toți, să citim acest pasaj din Scriptură. Chiar dacă aș vorbi în limbi omenești și îngerești, și n-aș avea dragoste. Sunt o aramă sunătoare sau un chimval zângănitor. Și chiar dacă aș avea darul prorociei și aș cunoaște toate tainele și toată știința, chiar dacă aș avea toată credința, spuneți toți, așa încât să mut și munții, și nu aș avea dragoste, ce sunt? Nu sunt nimic. Și chiar dacă mi-aș împărți toată averea pentru hrană săracilor, și chiar dacă mi-aș da trupul să fie ars și n-aș avea dragoste, nu-mi folosește la nimic. Dragostea, cum este? Îndelung răbdătoare, este plină de bunătate, dragostea nu pismuiește, dragostea nu se laudă, nu se umflă de mândrie, nu se poartă necuvincios, nu caută folosul său, nu se mânie, nu se gândește la rău, nu se bucură de nelegiuire, ci se bucură de adevăr. Acoperă totul. Și atunci când greșim, nu? Acoperă totul. Crede totul, nădăjduiește totul și suferă totul. Dragostea nu va pieri niciodată. Prorociile se vor sfârși. Limbile vor înceta. Cunoștința chiar va avea sfârșit. Căci cunoaștem în parte și prorocim în parte. Dar când va veni ce este desăvârșit, acest în parte se va sfârși. Când eram copil, vorbeam ca un copil, simțeam ca un copil, gândeam ca un copil. Când m-am făcut o mare, am lepădat ce era copilăresc. Acum vedem ca într-o oglindă, în chip întunecos, dar atunci vom vedea față în față. Acum cunosc în parte, dar atunci voi cunoaște de plin, așa cum am fost și eu cunoscut pe deplin. Acum, hai să spunem cu toții, acum dar rămân aceste trei, credința, nădejdea și dragostea. Dar cea mai mare dintre ele este dragostea. Dragostea care spune că fiecare persoană contează în fața lui Dumnezeu. Doamne, îți mulțumim pentru această seară. Îți mulțumim că Tu ne-ai vorbit și Ție ți-a păsat de fiecare dintre noi și în loc să ne pedepsești, Ți-ai dat ce ai avut mai scump pentru noi, că noi nu îl meritam pe Iisus, meritam pedeapsa. Doamne, ajută-ne să învățăm de la Tine că atunci când vrem să ne răzbunăm împotriva altora, să, în primul rând, să învățăm să iubim, să ne dăm înapoi și să iubim. Doamne, în numele Lui Iisus Hristos, acest mesaj al dragostei, ajută-ne să stea cu noi, să fie cu noi și săptămâna care urmează și să fie ca un izvor, ca un râu care curge din fiecare dintre noi. În acest fel să atingă și pe cei care nu Te cunosc pe Tine. Doamne, îți mulțumim pentru această seară, îți mulțumesc pentru mesaj, îți mulțumesc pentru cântări, îți mulțumesc pentru toți cei care s-au sacrificat, Dumnezeule. Te rog, Doamne, să ne ierți dacă ți-am greșit cu ceva și să ne ajuți ca să devenim o dragoste autentică, un râu care curge, plin de dragoste pentru ceilalți care nu Te cunosc pe Tine. Doamne, îți mulțumim în numele Lui Iisus Hristos. Amin. Să aveți o săptămână binecuvântată. Biserica este liberă.